Okay, very good. Okay.
Do you have any questions before you go up? No?
Good to go. Okay. So great to meet
you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, and we're going to get started with our second speaker. Once again, my name is Kevin O'Connor, and I'm an intern here at Young America's Foundation. And I have the pleasure of introducing Ms. Martha Boneta.
Oh, right.
She is the Senior Policy Advisor for America First Policies, which supports key policy initiatives that will work for all citizens in our country and put America first. She previously served as Executive Vice President for Citizens of the Republic, founded by Ronald Reagan in 1977. That foundation was relaunched in 2017 by several veterans of the Reagan administration. Ms. Boneta is a native Virginian and farmer on her family farm, Liberty Farm in Paris, Virginia. The Virginia House General Assembly honored her with a joint commendation from both the House and the Senate, recognizing Ms. Boneta for her significant contributions to the Commonwealth in 2016. Ms. Boneta graduated from the Antonin Scalia School of Law at George Mason University, where she received her Juris Doctor, and she also attended the Strauss Institute at the Pepperdine University School of Law in Malibu. Martha has two bills named after her in the oldest legislative body in the nation, the Boneta Bills 1 and 2, that protect property rights and cut burdensome red tape and legislation. Ms. Boneta is also the subject of a documentary film, Farming in Fear. She is the founder of the Piedmont Agriculture Academy and Liberty Hall Livestock Rescue, and has been on the board of directors for the Virginia Independent Consumers and Farmers Association and the Small Family Farm Foundation. She has also represented the Farm to Consumer Legal Foundation, advocating legislation and various other organizations. Martha Boneta is recognized as one of America's most amazing women by Country Woman magazine, and was inducted into the National Capital Friends of the National Rifle Association Hall of Fame in 2017. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Martha Boneta.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm thrilled to be here with YAF, and I'm excited to tell you about my personal story, overcoming overregulation and burdensome red tape. So before I do that, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. So we have folks here from all over our great nation, and I grew up not far from here in Mount Vernon, Virginia. I'm the youngest of three girls, and I grew up in a family where my mom and my dad taught us that if we work hard and we're dedicated in the United States of America, we can be anything we want in life. My childhood dream was to be a farmer. I grew up in a family where my grandmother lived with us, and we had these elaborate kitchen gardens in our backyard. And I loved the miracle of producing vegetables and fruits, and it was a lot of work. My big sisters didn't care for it, and my mom would say that our vegetables tasted so good because of George Washington's pigs that used to farm on our land that made the soil so rich. And from there really grew my dream to work hard and fulfill that American dream, that hard work ethic that I grew up with. So in 2006, we purchased Liberty Farm. And I can't take any credit for the name. It's been called Liberty Farm for many generations. And we started farming. And it was a lot of work, as all dreams are in the beginning. It starts with the dream, right? And to my heartache, instead of being able to farm, work hard, and achieve prosperity for myself and for my family, instead we encountered miles and miles of red tape and overregulation. And how did that happen? It happened because the local county government had shut our family down when we were in full-on harvest. So instead of being able to enjoy the fruit of our labor, instead of being able to open our doors to the community, to bring people onto the farm, to purchase our goods, instead we were shut down, and it was devastating. The locality had determined that what we were doing would require full-on permits, site plans, special exceptions, miles and miles of red tape that would cost hundreds of thousands of dollars and prevent us from starting our business, because small family farming is a small business. How many of you here come from a farming background, a farming family? That's wonderful. How many of you have worked on a family farm? Great, that's a great. And for the rest of you, how many of you eat food? Great. Perfect. Perfect. And so, as those of you that raised your hands know, from either working on a family farm, coming from a farming background, it's a labor of love. There are so many things in farming that we can't control. The weather, drought, and so forth. So as you can imagine, it was devastating. The locality had determined that we would need to go through this series of hoops in order to be able to engage in farming on farmland zoned rural agricultural in an agricultural county in a right to farm state. It was devastating. And when you think about it, farming is the heartbeat of our country. Our farmers built our great nation. Instead of lifting up farmers, entrepreneurs, small business people to be able to achieve their dream, to provide food to the community, to open up our doors to the public, to come and experience a working farm, they created roadblock after roadblock after roadblock, ultimately shutting us down. At first, I didn't know what to do, but I knew that it was wrong, and I knew that freedom and prosperity does not flourish when overregulation and red tape stifles the American dream, stifles the ability to fulfill the dream of entrepreneurship, right? So we ended up rallying and trying to pass legislation to provide for more opportunity, to prevent what happened to our family from happening to anybody anywhere in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And it took a lot of work. And many of you might be wondering, where do you begin? And for us, it wasn't just about our farm and our family. It was about farmers throughout the Commonwealth. But it was also about access to the public, to have access to what we were producing. So our message was not just for farmers, but it was for Americans throughout Virginia that wanted to have access to fresh, locally produced goods. They wanted to have options. They wanted to be able to go to the grocery store, but they also wanted to be able to come to their local family farm, experience a working farm, and purchase locally produced goods. So we ended up forming coalitions and grassroots activity all across the state to rally our legislature to pass a bill. And I'm honored and humbled that the bills carry my name, the Boneta bill, but it took a lot of work. And ultimately, we were able to pass not one, but two bills. What do these bills do? The bills say that if you're on farmland, you should be able to farm in peace without the government requiring miles and miles of red tape and regulation. And what the bill does is it allows for true entrepreneurial endeavors on a family farm without having to get permission from the government to work hard and fulfill the American dream. It took a lot of work. I've been in the battle for 10 years, but what did I learn from this experience? I learned that one person can make a difference. And it all starts with one dream, one idea, and knowing that together we can rise up and we can prevail and create an environment with limited government, limited regulation, and true opportunity. And so with that said, I'm gonna give you a quote from Ronald Reagan, because this is ultimately what I learned and what I carry in my heart everywhere I go. Profit, property, and freedom are inseparable. You can't have any one of them without the other. Those are powerful words, powerful words. Property, profit, and freedom. So I want to take you back a little bit to 1979. And I know that many people here were not alive in 1979. But it's important to do that, to really appreciate the true spirit of what a free market system means to our great nation. 1979, interest rates were soaring. They were around 20%. Unemployment, 13%. Inflation was through the roof. Can anybody here imagine what that was like in 1979? So communism was also on the march across the world. Jimmy Carter had said there was a certain malaise across our great nation. There was, in fact, a feeling that our country's best years were behind us. And today, how many of you believe that our best years are ahead of us? Indeed they are. The Republican Party in 1979 was at its lowest ebb since the Great Depression after Watergate. and had seen removal of sitting President Nixon. In the face of all of this, a great man stepped forward, and that man was Ronald Reagan. At that time, in the face of these challenges, Ronald Reagan took the national stage, and he gave our Republican Party a conservative movement, truly a revolutionary way forward. First, the Republican people nominated him. Then the American people elected him. So where are we today? Today, what would you think if someone said, capitalism has not always been here, and it will not always be here in the United States? What would you think? Okay. Bernie Sanders has said that. In fact, there are candidates that are currently running that have said these words. They have said that socialism is a good thing. But yet we all know this to be true, and that is that capitalism has lifted more people, more Americans, out of the muck and mire of poverty and despair than anything ever known to mankind in the United States and around the world. Ronald Reagan knew that. And not only did he know that, but it's what he did that would change the course of American history. It's what I personally know to be true. In 1979, not only was disco the rage, right? Which, by the way, I like disco. But in 1979, our nation was in a bad place because we had gotten away from the free markets and capitalism and peace through strength. But in 1980, something fantastic happened. In 1980, the American people elected Ronald Reagan. In 1981, he took office. And that would be a turning point in American history, and truly the world history. We had the greatest tax cuts in 1981 and 1983, deregulation, we rebuilt our national defense, and in fact, Reagan transcended communism. In 1988, interest rates were single digits. Peace and prosperity ruled throughout the United States and the world. And today, when we look at our administration, this administration, the Trump-Pence administration, we are seeing many of these achievements happening now. Historic tax cuts, knocking down red tape and regulation. So when I look across this room and I see all of you, I'm inspired beyond words. I see young Americans that are going to raise up the generation that is going to make sure that we win this fight. And make no mistake, we are in a fight. But what a great time it is to be alive. Would you agree? Yeah, absolutely, yes. And this is a generation worth fighting for. But really, it's up to you, the individual. And that's how it should be, right? So make no mistake, the fight is real. And human history is worth fighting for. The American dream is worth fighting for. And let's bring on the fight, because we are prepared, and all of you here today are the best of America, because you're here learning and fighting for the American dream. Before I say goodbye, I want to make sure that I leave you with a few words that I carry with me. Maintain your relationships. Your relationships with others, spreading the word of freedom and prosperity. Because steel sharpens steel. Steel sharpens steel. And your strength and your dedication and your passion is going to make your peers stronger and more skilled and ready for the fight. Go the extra mile. Do amazing things. Lift others up. And let your light shine bright. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. It's a true honor and a blessing. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Hannah. And
hi, Hannah.
I have a question. I come from Georgia, where agriculture is a big part of our economy. And I was wondering what you think we can do to help farmers who feel that really they're losing ground as far as playing into the economy in states like Georgia.
Oh, absolutely. And likewise, agriculture is Virginia's number one industry. It produces over 500,000 jobs. It pumps millions and billions of dollars into our economy. And as you know from Georgia, agriculture is a vast array of production. It's everything from tomatoes to wood, forestry, It's a vast plethora of products. And the American family farmer is the heartbeat of America. And property rights matter. Property rights and freedom are inseparable. And in fact, freedom stands on the shoulders of property rights. And time again, and we've seen this all across our country, right? We've seen this in the Midwest, where our ranchers are often felt like they are not heard and ignored. And what we're finding now is that, you know, what we're doing by having a loud voice, by protecting the property rights, which are so important, the ability for family farmers to farm in peace without the burdensome overregulation and red tape that the government inevitably tries to impose, not just on farmers, but on industry across the board. And we are in a great time for the American family farmer because we are witnessing firsthand the increasing demand for American-produced products. But the fight starts with us. And it starts with you, it starts with me, it starts with all of us. And that is making sure that we have limited government, that we're rolling back regulation, that we have a voice, that we are making sure that government doesn't run amok. And that's really what it's all about, is making sure that we are active in our local communities, that we're active in our local government, and we're active on a national basis. And that really is the best way to fight back against overregulation and provide more opportunity for the farming community in general, because it affects all of us. Whether you've ever grown a tomato or not, agriculture and farming affects every single one of us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you for sharing your story.
Thank you.
My name's Haley, and my dad has a small business that's landscaping in Connecticut, and we face the overregulation all the time. But specifically, we see national agencies like the EPA come in and take over for what should be the state's job. And even though I disagree with what the states do, it seems like a huge federal overreach. And I was wondering, when it seems almost hopeless to try to go from what should be a state issue into the national issue when they seem to attack your business, have you had any experiences with this, and how should you approach that?
Well, the EPA, I'm no friend of the EPA.
Neither am I.
The EPA has done more harm for prosperity across virtually every industry in our country. And, it needs to be shrunk it needs to be this big. The EPA needs to be this big. Would you all agree? Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And you know what you're saying rings true to me in particular, but to every business, whether you're a farmer, a landscaper, when you have a radicalized environmental agency that is empowered to limit and curtail what we're allowed to do on our land all across our country, it prevents prosperity. Because what it does is it stops businesses from being successful before they even get started. And so we are seeing this all across our country. There isn't a locality, there isn't a business all across our nation that hasn't felt the pain of overregulation. And the EPA has been empowered for far too long with the ability to really stifle businesses of every kind. And you know, there again, it's a situation where we need to be engaged and active in our communities on a local basis. And not only on a local basis, but across our states, across our country, fighting back. And you know, we are gonna win this fight. We are winning this fight right now with this administration. Yeah, thank you.
Gavi Greenspan, so you said multiple times that property rights is inherently connected to freedom, that in fact freedom rests on property rights in some way, shape, or form. Can you elaborate as to why you think constitutional freedoms such as freedom of speech and freedom of religion and freedom of the press are reliant on property rights?
Well, you know, there are. Well, let's just start with this for a moment. You know, there are places in the world where there are no property rights, right? The concept that we have as Americans that property rights are ingrained in what it means to live in the greatest nation on earth. There are places in the world where there are no property rights. You don't have the ability to own land. And by the way, our property rights are invaded and violated every single day. Every single day. There are places in our country where you can't have a Bible study without getting permission from the government. You can't engage in any number of activities on your property without permission from the government. So, you know, when you think of property rights, it's more than just owning a piece of land. It's the rights that come from possessing the ability to have quiet peace and enjoyment, under your roof, on your own property, without having to ask permission from the government. And those rights affect every aspect of our lives. Because if we allow our freedoms to be sacrificed in any way, it allows for a plethora, an avalanche of our freedoms to be sacrificed. So in every aspect of our lives, property is affected. It is, and it needs to be fought for and protected.
So I'm obviously in favor of free market and you know, freedom in general. So that being said, it seems that in the same way that overregulation kind of prevents the free market from running its course, government subsidies to various you know, markets may also prevent the invisible hand from, you know, doing its job. So I was wondering if you're in favor of subsidizing farming, and if so, why?
So we, our farm, we receive no subsidies whatsoever. We don't receive any grants. We don't receive any subsidies of any kind. That relies on us entirely through our hard work and labor. And the market works things out, or it should, right? But there's something inherently wrong when the market is warped because of subsidies, government handouts. How many of you are familiar with the tons and tons of cranberries that are dumped because of the government coming in and regulating the cost of cranberries? Are you familiar with this? Okay. If you don't know the story, the government wants to regulate the cost in the marketplace when it comes to cranberries. And cranberry producers had to dump tons of cranberries on the side of the road, on the side of their properties, and allow them to simply be destroyed. They couldn't be sold. They couldn't be utilized. Maybe the wildlife could come and enjoy them, but that's devastating. The government has no place fixing the market, and by having subsidies, what is that doing? What I'm asking you, what do subsidies do to the marketplace in this regard?
I mean, I believe that they, I mean, you're basically a subsidy would be giving money to certain, you know, aspect of the market to kind of influence the supply and demand, right?
Right, absolutely. There are subsidies to not grow anything on your land. There are subsidies to grow a certain product on your land. There are subsidies for virtually anything you can think of. And where does that end? And the marketplace works itself out, doesn't it?
Yeah.
The American people, the public, humans determine the marketplace. If a product isn't good, what happens? We don't buy it.
Yeah.
If it's too expensive, do we buy it? If it's too expensive, if we can't afford it? And what happens is it's the meddling of the system. And that's what we're seeing time and time again.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Morgan. I go to Stephen F. Austin State University in East Texas. Mm-hmm. And with your farming background, I just wanted to know what your perspective is on the tariffs and if it has a negative or positive impact.
That's a tough one. So how many, I'm curious, show of hands, how many people here support the tariffs? Okay, very, very good, very good. No, but let's talk about this. We have to talk about this. Why do you support the tariffs? And I get it, and I hear what you're saying. And let me answer this in two different ways. So tariffs affect all of us. Does anybody here think that tariffs don't impact every single one of our lives in here? It does. It really does. It affects every industry, and it affects all of our lives and our livelihood in one way or the other. So the president, with the tariff rollout, wants to even the playing field for Americans, to truly make America first, because where there are one such example is Canada, that has 270% on dairy. What does that do to our dairy producers in the United States? 270%. it ends access or limits access to our dairy producers into that marketplace. Do I believe that these tariffs will be there forever? Absolutely not. Do I believe that they are harming the industry and industries all across the board? Absolutely. But I don't believe that, that it's forever. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Katie Cupp. My question is more about the Trump administration. I was wondering if you think that Trump has done a good job of cutting the red tape, if you will.
So does everybody know how many regulations, that's an excellent question, by the way. Does everybody know how many regulations have been cut with every new law, sir? That's correct, but how many have actually been cut, sir?
Almost like 16.
21, on average 21. Think about that. Think about that. Now, this presidency has done so much in the short, you know, we just celebrated 500 days. And, you know, promises made, promises kept. And to be able to cut, on average, 21 new regulations, I mean, regulations with every new law is unprecedented. So that's something to really celebrate, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. And by the way, don't be discouraged about these tariffs. I mean, you know, they're causing pain, but I believe that that this is not forever, and we will, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. And yeah, yes ma'am.
Hi, I'm Abby Strew. I go to the University of Wisconsin, and I was wondering if you could elaborate on some of the regulations that you faced on your own farm.
Ah, wow, where do we begin? So.
I know there's a lot.
So in terms of, government abuse and overregulation. So imagine that you're at home and you get a knock on the door. And government and quasi-government, pseudo-government, radical environmentalists show up on your door and they start photographing and videotaping your personal private property. And when you say, wait a minute, what authority do you have to do this? We don't have to tell you, but you better listen to us. They came in, they photographed our personal private possessions, stood on our chairs to see what was in our attic space, rifled through our possessions. And when we would ask, what does this have to do with the environment? What does this have to do with protecting vital species that are in jeopardy? And the response was, we don't have to tell you, but you're required to listen to us. The one day we had students like yourselves that showed up on our farm. They wanted to learn where their food came from. And they were there to volunteer. They came from all over the country, and three sheriff's cars pull up. They demanded to know, they lined the students up, they demanded to know their names, their addresses, and their phone numbers on our farm. This is private property. And I had gone to the feed store to pick up some feed. I wasn't there. And one of the students called me and said, there's three sheriff's cars here, or maybe like two sheriff's cars and one government car. And they say they're from the zoning police, along with deputies, and they want to know who we are, and they're collecting our names and our phone numbers and our contact information. I said, you're not giving it to them, are they? Are you? Because you have, you know, there's no warrant, you're doing nothing wrong. That's government abuse. I mean, we as the American people can have whoever we want to on our private property, whether it's a farm, whether it's your home, whether it's your business. What business is it of the government to know who's on your farm? That's how egregious and abusive. When the government wants your property, when they want to take away your rights, they don't have to come with a bulldozer to do it. They can overregulate you out of your rights and your freedom and your ability to support yourselves and your family. And that is exactly what we experienced on our farm. The list is long of the things that they did, but you know, constant surprise inspections, demanding and requiring that we get permission, having to report to the government exactly what we were doing on our farm at all times. At one point, the radical environmental group wanted to install 24/7 surveillance cameras to spy on us so they could see what we were doing 24/7. Egregious abuse of privacy and property rights. I mean, this is not the America that our forefathers fought for, that our active duty are fighting for, that we believe in. You know, the beacon of hope for America and for the world. And that's what we experienced on our farm. Wild abuse of authority, an unhinged government and environmentalists that want to control every aspect of our lives. And so, you know, that's what we experienced. And the fight is still, although we did fight and prevail, the fight is ongoing. because when we stop and rest and think that we have won, we can never stop. The fight is forever to fight for freedom and liberty. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Uh-huh.
Don't get me wrong. I'm against overregulation too. Yeah. But don't you think there should be a balance where we check the safety, in this case, of our food? Like, we ought to know that our food is safe, right?
Yeah, but that's a different regulatory body.
Okay.
Yeah. So in other words, it's not that the folks that were limiting us were limiting us from being able to exercise our rights to farm at all, or to engage in any agricultural activity. It's not the Food and Drug Administration. The Food and Drug Administration didn't bother us. The ability to grow to produce our food on our farm, which is a right to farm state, which, by the way, most states across the country have right to farm laws codified, and which is an inherent. If you own farmland, rural agricultural production, farming, you have the right to engage in rural agricultural production. And so it wasn't a food issue. It wasn't a food safety issue, which is just, you know, it's one of that. That's just another alphabet soup of government regulations. It was property rights.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. But great question.
Hey there. My name's Kevin. I'm at the University of Virginia.
Ah, very good.
My question is about government regulation, and if you think there's a difference at whether those regulations are implemented at different levels of government. Do you think a regulation that could be illegitimate at the federal level might be legitimate at the state level, or might be legitimate at the local level?
Well, absolutely. It depends on what we're talking about, right? But you know, at the end of the day, less government is more freedom. Period. End of story. The question when I hear people say, you know, can we do this? Right? You know, tell us why we can't do it. I mean, seriously. I mean, you know, we're at a point now where instead of being able to go out and be entrepreneurial, be creative, think outside of the box and engage the marketplace in that regard, it should be lifting those ideas up instead of asking the government permission if we can do it, right? So if you start with that premise, I mean, absolutely. I mean, it just depends, right, on what the issue is. But absolutely, you know, everything starts at the local level, without question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Scott from Gettysburg College. My question is just, between all of these regulations and the new technologies, do you think small family farms can survive all the damage that's already been done?
That's a great question. So does anybody know, that is a great question. Does anybody know the average age of the American family farmer? Take a guess. Well, there are 14-year-old farmers. There are, because a lot of farm families, everybody engages in agriculture. Everyone in the whole family works in a small family farm. But the average age is about 55. And a lot of the next generation doesn't want to engage in farming because overregulated to death, earning a penny or two on the dollar of what's produced. And they see this sea of red tape. And so, you know, the small family farmer is constantly in jeopardy. And these are make no mistake, these are small businesses. These are small businesses, just like any other business. And so, you know, that struggle is real. And the more regulations that are piled on make it increasingly more difficult to survive and be competitive. So yeah, that's a real, the struggle of the small producer is real. But we're seeing this great hunger for locally produced foods. How many of you go to farmers markets, right? They're popping up everywhere on college campuses. When I was in college, we didn't have a farmers market on our campus, and now they're on college. Farmers markets are coming to the colleges all across the country, and that's a beautiful thing. Local restaurants are starting to put where the food is coming from on the menus. You may have seen that. They'll say, you know, your eggs came from this farm within such a close proximity. And so all of these opportunities that are opening up for the small producer are helpful. And the less regulation and burdensome red tape, we'll see to it that they continue to thrive and prosper. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, guys, let's give it up for our speaker one last time.
Thank you guys so much. Thank you. Mm-hmm.